external fields, in particular with light fields or with external fields.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So the idea of this today's lecture is to tell you more how atoms interact. I'm coming from a Helmholtz Institute in Jena. This is very roughly speaking half the way from Munich to Berlin. It's a small university town, and we are associated also to this university. I divide it into two parts, a short one at the beginning, where I try to give you a small view what I understand from an atomic theory side about the theory and the computation in a certain sense in a nutshell. And you're all aware, of course, of the first three processes. We should get a feeling what type of processes do we have to interact with atoms or ions in our case. Of course, you all know spontaneous emission as well as the stimulated emission and the photoionization. This means Einstein's photoelectric effect. It is clear if you stimulate with a light field, then you can stimulate the emission or the absorption. And you know from lasers, of course, that basically in this case you get photon fields which share the same properties like the incoming with respect to phase, frequency, polarization, all this stuff. This spontaneous emission is also, of course, you are aware that this is a very important process, but it is much harder to understand because it occurs even without an ambient electromagnetic field. And of course, we have first to find the relation, how it is related to other. But these are only a few of the possible processes. You can also have something like photon scattering, which stands here for Rayleigh and Compton scattering, which means the elastic or the inelastic scattering of X-rays or gamma rays by atoms or molecules, or a particular case, Thomson scattering, which can be considered as the low energy limit of Compton scattering, that you say that the momentum transfer which you make by absorbing or by scattering a photon becomes negligible with respect to the energy, to the rest energy of the atom who absorbs. But of course, you have even more processes like multiphoton excitation and ionization processes, or also multiphoton decay processes, which is a signature of a known linear electron-photon interaction that the signal increases non-linear quadratically or even in a higher power with the intensity of the photon field, but this appears also under certain circumstances with respect to the decay, and which is then associated with the spontaneous processes. There are more, like ionization or electron impact excitation and ionization, and we can add, even if we go to higher energies, something like, of course, pair production, the creation of particles and antiparticles from the internal interaction of light with matter, the creation basically of electron-positron pairs in the first instance, or even if we go further to something like Dalbrook scattering, which is really a process which can be understood only in the framework of quantum electrodynamics if we, in addition to the quantized atom, also quantize the electromagnetic field. Of course, in practice, the distinction in the discussion of these different atomic and electron-photon interaction processes, and one could add certainly a few more here, of course, also depends on the community. And I try to relate my talk a little bit also what I have seen yesterday with respect to your poster. But to make it short, what is the aim of atomic theory is, of course, that starting from a wide range of many body methods and techniques, the central goal is, in ab initio atomic structure and collision theory, to describe not only the electronic level structure, of course also these, but also the properties and the dynamical behavior on the basis of the many electron Schrödinger equation, or by applying even slightly more advanced techniques. This is certainly not what I will tell today. We restrict mainly to this part, or even to the phenomenological side. First of all, one has to get a feeling. Because until the present, this has turned out to be a really ambitious task with a lot of surprises if it really comes to detail. On the other hand, atomic theory is this theory which is considered as a playing ground in order to understand new many-body techniques, and many of the techniques which are nowadays used for molecules, solid state also, they have been in the first instance tested with regard to atoms. One of the ideas, of course, today is also to train and to talk with you together about physical intuition, because this is typically beneficial or at least helpful in this sense in going ahead. Yuri very nicely explained yesterday how you come to many electron wave function, what are the central steps. I take a slightly general view at the beginning that in order to understand the interaction of atoms, and one could generalize it, of course, also to molecules, but we are here in a framework of atoms and ions and plasmas mainly, is one should have a good feeling about the hierarchy of atomic interaction. It is obvious, the first two parts, the nuclear potential and the electron-electron interaction, this is basically what forms you an atom, and without this, we would not need to talk about atoms or ions. But then, as you saw yesterday in Yuri's lecture, spin-orbit interaction starts to play an important role. And if you go from light elements towards medium and heavy elements, of course, also relativistic contributions. You have to recognize that the electrons, they move faster and faster as heavier the nuclear charge, in particular the inner shell electrons. And we often say that the 1s or the k-shell electron in something like uranium, it has already about 65 to 70% of the speed of light. And it is obvious that in this case, you have really a relativistic description and you have the need for relativistic effects, which phenomenologically comes in two ways. One of them is, of course, you have currents, the electrons orbit around the nucleus. You have a small current, and with this current, you have associated a magnetic moment, as you know from classical mechanics. The interaction of these classical moments leads basically to something like spin-spin interactions, as well as you have a retardation, which is indicated here, that the interaction is not with the position which is at this given time, but it is felt in a retarded way, because you have to take into account that you don't have an instantaneous interaction among the electrons, but you have a retardation if you really become comparable with the speed of light. Up to now, one is on the level that up to this, what is everything in this yellow box, one is in principle able to include self consistently, to describe this in a nice fashion, including more or less, in depending whether it is necessary, also the relativistic contribution. But as it was indicated yesterday already, and if I want to point out further today, of course, you have also still the interaction with the radiation field, and this is something which you feel in the spontaneous emission, but also see in the context, of course, of shifts with regard to energy levels, which are associated with the quantum electrodynamic effects. And if you look even closer, you will recognize that you see the properties of the nucleus, known as the hyperfine structure, as well as if you look even closer, you would start to see the electric and magnetic distributions inside of the nucleus. And you can turn the view around that in order to understand something about the nuclei, one often uses nowadays precise laser spectroscopy in order to deduce out of this so-called isotope shifts, which basically has two components. One of the different fields which arises from the nuclear potential, and which arises basically from the composition of protons and neutrons inside of the of the nucleus, as well as an effect which is called the mass, or the mass polarization, which is not an inherent interaction which would appear on the Hamiltonian, but which is a consequence, basically, of the conservation of momentum, that one, and which appears, basically, in a very similar manner within a given Hamiltonian. You would also see something like this. So in order to talk about different processes, one should have a good idea about this hierarchy and up to which point you should include it into your description. It is not at all wise in atomic theory to start immediately from the most complete theory. This would be, in our case, quantum electrodynamics, but even 80 years after development of quantum mechanics, we are not much better than that we are able to deal with hydrogen, and even hydrogen only basically up to a two-photon exchange in the QED picture with respect to set alpha to the fourth power. Also, you see, one is very much limited, and one has to learn from this hierarchy. And this leads us also to the models. While we are used to describe the electronic structure of the atoms and ions in a quantum mechanical sense, that of course we say these are quantum systems and we need to describe them in terms of wave functions, of energy levels, all what was yesterday explained based on a more or less well-defined atomic Hamiltonian. The interaction of the atoms with the radiation field is hardly described in a quantized manner. Here we use a trick, and I will explain this in a minute in more detail, that the radiation is in almost all cases described by a classical field. And the purpose is that, of course, it would be much too cumbersome to try to deal everything right from the beginning. The only exception is where one leaves this, typically in quantum optics, where you have to deal with the interaction of individual atoms with individual photons, like, for instance, in cavity QED, where you can have a control of one or few photons in a cavity interacting in a well-defined way with one or a few atoms. Where I am now. By using the semi-classical treatment, of course, we are able to describe a large number of problems, but only for the price that we have to incorporate in an ad hoc manner, and I will explain this, this quantum effect, the coupling to the electromagnetic field, which, for instance, is responsible for spontaneous emission in this way that we have to add it in ad hoc treatment, and as I said, a full treatment. One point which I typically like to make at this point, that apart from this hierarchy of the interaction, you should also be aware about the hierarchy of time scales. Of course, you all know if we talk about optical fluorescence or near ultraviolet fluorescence, typical lifetimes range in the order of nanoseconds or part of nanoseconds, and which is comparable, for instance, with the folding time of proteins. But if we go down in time, we see that we will enter, of course, not also the molecular degrees of freedom, like the rotations and vibrations, but also that we come to basically to the time scale of the electronic motion. And this is responsible for the ionization. And this explains you also why, for light elements at least, you have here typically a dominance of the ionization in comparison to the coupling to the radiation field, as long as you don't have, of course, driving fields. And this is also the reason why the atomic time unit, you know, it is just 24 attoseconds. This is related basically to the motion of the electron. Of course, these numbers all arise from the hydrogen atom, but of course are characteristic also for many other systems. Okay, just to conclude this first part, of course, I don't need to tell you too much about the need of having a good atomic theory and of having also an accurate atomic theory. The majority of posters which I saw yesterday came from the first three with regard to astrophysical as well as plasma physical interpretation and diagnostics. There are also a couple of posters regarded to EUV lithography. But I would like to make you aware that there has been perhaps not as large as these first three communities. There are further communities which are highly dependent basically on a good atomic description and also on the way how we understand the coupling basically to external fields and particle collision. This is one of them is the atomic clocks, where one has enormous precision achieved. You perhaps know that in this type of laser spectroscopy, they get an incredible accuracy of often 8, 10, 12 digits of accuracy to determine transition frequency, frequency comp, as just as a keyword. And here one becomes sensitive not only with respect to all this detailed interaction in the Hawaii key, but one may become even sensitive to the black body radiation, to the coupling, basically, to Planck's law in this particular case. Another community is the search for heavy and super heavy elements, which is going on originally from the 60s in order to find the island of stability beyond set equivalent 114, 116. They didn't determine it at the beginning. Now it is obvious that this very stable island will not exist. But nevertheless, the idea is to complete or to extend further this nuclear chart, the chart of nuclear isotopes, where meanwhile in the order of 3,000 nuclei are known and of course need to be also characterized. And only a small fraction, perhaps 10 to 15% of these isotopes are stable or reasonably stable. All the others are radioactive and decay often in very short time. This is related also to nuclear physics, that they want to use atomic type of spectroscopy in order to derive information about the nuclear properties like the nuclear spins or the nuclear moments. Of course, it's also related to surface and environmental physics, but what I would like to make you aware here in this context just that it is also, of course, associated with fundamental physics to use this low energy physics to understand signatures about new physics that go beyond the standard model. Also in this case, one needs precise data, and this can be considered to some extent as a competition or as an alternative to high energy physics, to CERN-like physics, as well as, of course, related to the foundation. So this basically is a framework why it is worth to look in particular into this coupling. And this brings me to the second topic, which I now want to explain in much further detail with regard to the interaction of atoms in weak fields. I restrict myself to weak fields where we have the situation that the radiation field, for instance, or the field which is associated with the collision in the sense of a Lennard-Wishart potential are so weak in comparison to the internal fields which is felt by the electron in its motion around the nucleus that it doesn't affect the electronic structure, so that we can still talk about the level structure as it was explained yesterday. The first, what we of course should look at if we talk about radiative transitions, the coupling of atoms to the radiation field refers to the well-known Einstein coefficient or to the spontaneous emission or spontaneous and stimulated emission, which is represented by this A and B. And it was indeed a genius idea of Einstein. It was 1917, well before the development of quantum mechanics, that he put up this statistical model and considered a two-level model of the atom, where he say we have just the atom which can occupy levels E1 and E2 with occupation numbers N1 and N2. And can we somehow understand this strange process spontaneous emission. It's the interaction to a radiation field if there's no radiation field in our classical perception around. And of course, as you see here, what happens is you can, of course, excite, stimulated excites. This is basically absorb photons as well as spontaneously emits this A21 as B21. And this is, of course, the stimulated processes. They should be related to something what is known as the spectral energy density, or in a more simplified way, is the number of useful photons, the number of photons per volume, and in particular, per frequency range, which helps you to excite a particular transition. We all know that, of course, the line widths of atomic transition or ionic transition are pretty small, so you have to fit with your frequency range quite well to the frequency which is needed to make an excitation. Just to show you very briefly, Einstein's argumentation at this point was that, of course, the change, the loss of atoms in the level 2 is just the gain in the level 1 related per time interval. And, of course, you can immediately write down why is the stimulated emission and the stimulated absorption are associated with the spectral density, the spontaneous process occurs in addition. And this helps us to give us basically a relation between the emission and the absorption probabilities. Interesting, if there's no fields, this means this rho of omega is equivalent zero. This right two terms basically become zero, and you immediately see that's a well-known weightative decay law that basically is associated by a constant A, which appears here as the inverse lifetime, or which is just the Einstein A coefficient. Of course, in equilibrium, we have the situation that neither dN2 by dt nor dN1 changes, and we immediately get, by just using this formula, this relation between the stimulated absorption and the spontaneous and stimulated emission process as a ratio which can be resolved now together by using basically a statistical consideration with regard to this Boltzmann constant. The idea what Einstein brought in addition, of course, it's the so-called principle of detailed balance, that it, the process with respect to two levels should be independent with respect to the processes for the other levels, so that we can consider them independently, and which means now that instead of one A coefficient, we typically have to sum over all this Einstein A coefficient with regard to lower lying levels, the decay possibility, and this together, given in the inverse, of course, still gives us the lifetime, basically, of such an atomic level. If we can use this relation here above in order to determine also the ratio between the spontaneous and the stimulated emission or absorption probabilities together with this statistical factor as well as with Planck's power law with regard to radiation. And if we put this together, Einstein found, as I said, well before the development of quantum mechanics, that basically we have a key how we can describe this process of the spontaneous emissions, this spontaneous coupling in terms of the stimulated process. As you see here in front of it, appears a factor, apart from some other constant like h bar and c, appears a factor omega ij to the third power. And this is also why in some fields of atomic physics, basically the spontaneous processes are the important one, like in the optical region or in even ultraviolet or X-ray region. But we said it is pretty unimportant if one goes, for instance, to masers to microwave fields, because then you have several order of magnitudes lower frequency, and if you take it to the third power, it is well understandable that all these effects basically can be neglected. But I want to make you aware, of course, this is only one contribution which determines the line widths here. Again, with respect to this orange sodium line, this D2 line, which was discussed yesterday in Yuri's lecture, that if we compare it for this particular line, the natural line widths with the line widths which is given by the motion under standard condition here for a temperature of 500 Kelvin, we see first of all that this natural line width is pretty small. It is in the order of 0.1 gigahertz. If you combine these numbers and put them together, this relative ratio, while the Doppler width becomes as large for a temperature of 500 Kelvin, which is certainly not yet a hot plasma, in the relation of 12 gigahertz. So we have here two or sometimes even more orders of magnitude, and it would require a very cold atom beam or even cold gases in the sense of cooling them down in order to make these widths comparable. So far, we have the lucky situation that we know how the spontaneous and the stimulated processes are related. Of course, what we need in order to understand this, we need basically to understand how we can describe it. And this is of course also related to Einstein's assumption that this coefficient, Einstein A and B coefficient, they are properties of the atom. So that's the overall interaction, and you know it perhaps from Rabi oscillation, from driving field, is always decomposed or factorizes into a part which is determined by the atoms. These are exactly these coefficients, basically the coupling strengths, as well as the field properties of the field. And how to obtain now what we call transition probabilities, or this lifetimes, if we have to sum up, then of course to give you just a sketch here, that we have a radiation field which is time dependent, which introduces a time dependent interaction, and we have the atomic structure, and of course we need to take into account this atom field coupling. And again, there are two possibilities in order to deal with it. The first one, which is the preferred one in atomic and in particular also in plasma physics, is this semi-classical consideration that we quantize the atom, but that we deal with a classical electromagnetic field, while in the QED picture, we would have to quantize both, but for the price that the theory becomes really elaborate and cumbersome, and people have tested it for individual transition, but it would be lead completely out of control if you really describe more complex atoms within this framework. There's no chance to keep this type of treatment feasible. Just to indicate what are the limitations of our semi-classical description. As I said, this is a way that we ad hoc somehow remember this Einstein relation and take it over in order to describe all the time. If we deal with the coupling with the radiation field, we know from our classical consideration how to deal with a, or semi-classical consideration, how to deal with a coupling for the stimulated processes, and we take in addition this ad hoc manner, this spontaneous processes into account. Of course, in classical fields, the relative importance of the spontaneous emission is reduced. If we have, in addition, also driving field, and it would be even more reduced if we have strong fields, which is not the topic of this today's lectures, also strong in the sense that you really come in with intensities which are comparable or much larger in the field strengths than with regard to the internal atomic fields. But how to deal now with this classical description? You perhaps remember in this case, you have to replace your atomic Hamiltonian p squared over 2m, this momentum, by the canonical momentum, which is given by p plus e times a, where a is the spatial part of the four potential. This phi is basically the time component, or the representation of the Coulombic part of the potential in most cases. If we now start from this type of Hamiltonian, you see that in addition to the atomic case, which you know all from your quantum mechanic lecture, we got a term where we have p dot a and a dot p, which if we consider both as operators, we should be careful not to combine them. But if we have a classical field, of course, this is nothing else than a multiplication operator, and we combine this immediately to 2p dot a. And in particular, we would also have a term which is a squared. But to make this story short, basically we divide our Hamiltonian into an atomic Hamiltonian, something very familiar to us, and where we understood from the yesterday lecture how to determine the level structure, as well as an atomic field interaction. And one can put these pieces together. Usually one makes a plane wave expansion, but what I want to point out at this is only that you have now, in the framework of time-dependent perturbation theory, the possibility to deal with this atom under the inclusion of this time-dependent a dot p. This a is here time-dependent. We make time-dependent perturbation theory. And if you remember the general framework, then of course we end up with Fermi's rule. And what we achieved at this moment is that we can relate the stimulated processes and the coefficients which describe the stimulated processes as a property of the atom, basically to a so-called transition matrix element. What is here inside is nothing still than this A dot P term by making this special ansatz, as well as, of course, the transition from an initial state to I to some final state J. And because we talk about the probability, we have, of course, here not the matrix element as itself, but the modulus square of this matrix element. And now one can, of course, what one has to do, one has to analyze basically this type of transition amplitude or this type of matrix element to understand how the atom couples with respect to the light field. Here it is written all for a single electron system like atomic hydrogen, but one can more or less easily generalize it by saying that, of course, in a many-particle electron, the momentum of each electron interacts, of course, with the radiation field. So what we have to do is basically we have to deal with this type of transition matrix element. Of course, our surroundings, our daily experience is based more or less purely on electric dipole interaction. That, of course, in this frequency range, which we are used to have, optical frequencies, but also ultraviolet, and of course, in particular, also for all lower frequency range, we can say that basically the atomic radius is much, much smaller than basically the typical variation of the field over a single wavelength. For this particular example of visible light, lambda 500 nanometers, you can easily estimate that an atom is about 1,000 to 10,000 times smaller than this wavelength, which means that all the electron basically sees at a given time the same field. And what does it mean from a mathematical viewpoint? We can, from this exponential factor e to the I kr, make an expansion and simply use the first term, constant field, which is felt by all the electron. This is a dipole approximation, that over the size of the atom, the light field is constant. And then you can analyze these matrix elements. I will not go into these details at this point. Just say that what one has to use is now the symmetry properties of the wave function, like it was explained yesterday. And that one has to use that, of course, an atom is spherical symmetric system, so it has a well-defined total angular momentum, it has a well-defined projection, as well as, of course, a parity with respect to a reflection of all the coordinates with regard to the origin. This we, you know, from hydrogen, and the same applies for all atoms, at least to a very good approximation, as long as you are not considering something like parity non-conserving interaction, but they come on a very tiny level, 10 to the minus 7, 10 to the minus 8 degree, if at all. And so what one has to do at this point is basically this spontaneous, one can express this spontaneous emission now in terms of these, just of these matrix elements, where it becomes clear that for optical transitions, this is a very important process, but that it goes down due to the scaling which we had before between A and the stimulated B coefficients with regard to lower frequency. And we also see more or less immediately, because of this omega 3, we have basically a set to the third power. So increases this importance of this spontaneous processes increases with the third power in the nuclear charge. This is just the leading term. If we go back from this expansion of the exponential factor, we can discuss also, of course, higher multipoles in a minute. I just want to make you aware that this is only half of the discussion, that we know the coupling strengths, also expressed basically in terms of these Einstein coefficients, and which we would call this is a knowledge of the transition probabilities. The second part is, of course, how are these levels populated? And if you think on a plasma, of course, here comes into play statistical methods that you, or the statistical considerations that you have to get a model, how your levels are populated. In the case of atomic spectroscopy, this is typically associated with the excitation process. So the excitation together with the coupling to the radiation field determines how much you will see from this line. What is a very nice tool which helps you to understand, basically, is the selection rules. That one says if we use simply the symmetry of the wave function, in details this looks sometimes a bit technical, and I will not do this in all this technical detail, but of course one simple argument, for instance, if we look at this electric dipole term, is that if we basically make a reflection of R goes to minus R, then out of the symmetry of the hydrogenic wave function, and something similar we would find also for the multi-electron case, is that basically you get a factor minus 1 to the 2L plus 1, which means that an electric dipole transition, this dominant part in the electron-photon operator, can only be act if you have a transition from an even to an odd parity state. In all other cases, it could not combine these levels, you would get more or less matrix elements which are identical zero with respect to this part of the electron-photon interaction. Also, that delta L, which is equivalent, is plus or minus 1. Of course, it is odd. And if one goes through these technical details, one would see that basically in order to understand this transition probabilities, this coupling to the radiation field, that it can be typically factorized in a part which you really have to calculate, basically it's the evaluation of radial integrals, which determines the intensity, plus what I often call a geometrical factor, which is basically given by the angular part of this wave function, and which can also differ a little bit in the size, but this is much less than what it comes in from this radial part. So this radial part really determines basically the strength of the coupling. And what can be done for the electric dipole approximation can, of course, now be continued to discuss the next terms apart from the dipole term. This is I k dot r, which gives rise both to the so-called magnetic dipole as well as to the electric quadrupole rotation. And here again, one can benefit from the symmetries of this of the wave function in order to understand under which circumstances we have a known vanishing contribution. How the selection rules act in this particular case. Selection rules, first of all, it's always related to the symmetry of the wave function. Second, what you should be aware, selection rules are almost never strict in atomic physics. It's always strict only with certain parts of the electron-photon coupling. So you find exception, I will discuss it later on, that how they come into play. It only shows you the hierarchy of the interaction. And you, for instance, während the magnetic dipole is still related to a vector operator, this is basically the magnetic moment of the electron as a transition operator, we have the situation that for electric quadrupole, which both comes out of these terms, we are now related to a second order tensor operator, basically to the quadrupole operator, which those who remember classical field theory, electromagnetic fields, you have it, of course, also in the multipole expansion of the electromagnetic field. If you put these details together, you understand, however, and this is the main message from using this selection rules, that the electric dipole relative to the magnetic dipole relative to the electric quadrupole, and one could go on to higher orders by including higher orders from this expansion, it scales roughly like 1 through alpha squared, where alpha is the fine structure constant. So you know right from the beginning, this magnetic dipole or electric quadrupole is typically suppressed by 4, 5 orders of magnitude. Of course, one should be taking certain care about this statement under certain circumstances. We will see that this is not immediately given by this factor, but this is a scaling with regard to the coupling of this field. And before I still have a few minutes, I can discuss here these dipole transitions in many electron atoms. Here, not much need to be said. It becomes more technical, and it would be impossible to give this sketch just in order to see that the symmetry always fulfilled within a few lines. First of all, one should deal with the decomposition of this into spherical tensors. This is done something like here, that basically you have a representation of the dipole transition operator, which is now written in terms of spherical tensors, still a sum over all the individual operators for the electrons, 1 to n in a many electron system, as well as, of course, now decomposed into radial component times basically functions which transform themselves like the spherical harmonics. And of course, the spherical harmonics are one set. This basically sets of physical quantities which transform themselves like the spherical harmonics are considered as spherical tensors, and they are usually helpful to immediately or to simplify the evaluation for these many electron atoms. But to come back to the physics, what does it mean now if we consider just this simple hydrogenic Grotian diagram or energy level diagram? Of course, this electric dipole it need to connect levels of different parity, and where this delta J is just zero or plus minus one. So the electric dipole transition is from PS, like you know, or from DP or SP, all this stuff where you just have a change in the parity as well as a change in delta J by zero or plus minus one. The magnetic dipole, in contrast, it can relate also levels of the same parity. So for instance, 2s to 1s can decay via a magnetic dipole. It is much, much weaker for standard under standard condition, as well as we have the situation that we have by M1, because we have 3/2 and 1/2 to combine, it is both possible a magnetic dipole as well as an electric quadrupole, which again has the same parity of the initial and final states, but will have, of course, the possibility to connect also levels with delta J up to 2. And this can be continued, even though in the non-relativistic theory, one typically stops with the magnetic and the electric quadrupoles. If one wants to go beyond, and there are many reasons to do so, it is usually more helpful to use such a multipole expansion in the relativistic regime, where you don't have any more this P dot A term, multiplied, of course, with the electric charge. But this is now replaced by a alpha dot A. Alpha is the Dirac matrices, the vector of the Dirac matrices. So it becomes now operators with a 4 times 4 representation, which itself acts, of course, on a 4 component spinor. So doing this, we are well in the middle of the relativistic theory. I will not touch this explicitly, but I want to make you aware that this would be the way in order to include also higher multipoles, and I discuss in the second part of my lecture how that this is that there exist many situations where this is useful. Just to show you here how it scales, you see that while the electric dipole scales with a third power in the nuclear charge, the scaling of the magnetic dipole as well as the electric quadrupole and also magnetic quadrupole is quite differently. Here shown for the blue line, the magnetic quadrupole scales with the 8th power and the M1 with the 10th power. So that if you go along, for instance, the hydrogenic sequence from neutral hydrogen to something like hydrogenic uranium, which can be investigated in nice detail at storage rings, for instance, then, of course, you will have the situation that some of the processes which are completely negligible in one region of the periodic table becomes really essential and important in the other. But with regard to the selection rules, as I said, they are never strict. They are only strict with respect to certain parts of the electron-photon coupling operator. We still have the same rules like here, that if you have electric multipole, in general, you need basically a change in the parity. You need a change in depending minus n to the L. As an electric dipole, you need. Electric quadrupole, you don't need, and so on. Whereas with the magnetic, it is just the other way around. Magnetic dipole don't need a change in the parity, and an electric quadrupole, a magnetic quadrupole would need. So it is often a competition to the electric dipole. And still, you can express it that basically in this so-called triangular delta, that the total angular momentum of the initial and of the final state together with the multipolarity of the photon field, this is represented by this L, it should fulfill the triangular rule. It must be possible to form out of these three integers and triangle. Okay, perhaps I simply say two words more. What I wanted to say is with respect to the scaling rules, this nuclear charge set, that you see that you have a very different scaling with respect to the electric multipole, magnetic dipole, electric dipole, magnetic dipole, as well as the magnetic quadrupole. And we will see later on in our discussion, this is only one way that it couples once with the radiation fields. There are also higher order processes, so-called higher order processes like E1, E1 or 2E1 processes, which scales with a 6 power or something, of course, also the decay of E1, M1, for instance, in beryllium-like ions. The lowest level beyond of the 2s squared singlet as a zero ground state is the 2s2p. This was one example which Yuri Yester calculated, the 2s2p triplet p0. And this triplet p0, because it's a zero to zero transition, it cannot decay by a single photon, at least as long as there's no nuclear spin. And in this case, you have to use something like such an electric dipole, magnetic dipole as the leading term in this. On the other hand, you understand that all these are only part of an expansion, which tells you a hierarchy in the interaction, but in most cases, not a very strict rule. And with this one, I want to conclude. Let's come back five past 10, and I will tell you in the second part more. Thank you.